Now we're going to start with our questions, and I'll start mine with Ms. Daniel Davis. Within a week of taking office, President Biden issued an executive order that directed the Secretary of Interior to pause new oil and natural gas leases on public lands and offshore waters pending a comprehensive review of the Secretary's stewardship responsibilities, including climate impacts from oil and gas developments. Several states challenged the order, and in June, a federal district court granted a preliminary injunction against the leasing pause. The Justice Department is appealing the district's court's decision in the Fifth Circuit, but the department has said that oil and gas leasing, both onshore and offshore, will continue in the meantime. So if you can give me the current status of the leasing program, and is the pause still in place, or has leasing resumed as before?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for the question and confirming that the leasing program onshore and offshore is going forward per the court's direction.
Also, are we producing as much oil and gas as we were before the pause?
I appreciate that follow-up. And in fact, we are. The production has stayed at levels consistent with past administrations. And as you know, the pause did not impact ongoing permitting on legally held leases. So that has continued. The jobs associated with that have continued. So we've got about 9,000 plus permits available for use as well.
The other thing is something that's bothered me more than any of them is the review of the leasing program was supposed to result in the release of a report earlier this summer. But the report, as you know, the report still hasn't been released. So what is the status of the report?
Thank you so much for that question, Mr. Chairman. The report, as you know, is being developed as part of the comprehensive review that the President asked us to do under an executive order. We've had a really robust engagement process. There is a lot to review. Reports like this that come at the direction of an executive order do go through an appropriate interagency and White House review process, and that is where we are.
So it's in the White House as far as reviewing the report that you all have, or is yours completed now?
Well, it is undergoing the interagency and White House review process. And of course, there's new information that is developed that we can continue to review and include.
And when should we expect it?
I'm hoping we'll be able to get it out the door very soon.
Well, we're past summer, so that means it's fall, huh?
Yes, sir.
But we're going to be asking for it. We want to see that. It would really be helpful for all of us. Ms. Touton, if we're fortunate that President Biden has chosen to place Western Water Policy in the hands of two former members of our committee staff, and we have a lot of interest in this, and they have dire need. I got plenty of water in West Virginia. We'd love to be able to ship it out to y'all any way we could if we could get it there. But that's a deal. We'll put that line in. There's one pipeline we can all agree on. So I spoke earlier in my opening remarks about the number of dams and reservoirs the Bureau of Reclamation manages. But do you agree that the job of Commissioner of Reclamation is not so much about managing dams and reservoirs as protecting the water supplies that millions of Americans depend on?
Thank you for that question, Senator. I agree with you completely that my time in service to the members of this committee has best prepared me for this position, though I must say this is the first time I've viewed the room from this angle. I agree with you. As a Westerner, as a Nevadan, there is nothing more important than your water and the management of your water supplies. The Bureau of Reclamation is the largest deliverer of water in the nation. And so part of that is being able to utilize our significant infrastructure. But the most important part of managing your water supplies is working with your partners, with the states, with the tribes, and with all of the communities on this important research in the West.
Well, I'm sure you're aware of the critical situation that we have out West.
Yes, Senator.
Okay, and the people that are in dire need. We're going to have senators that will go more in-depth than that, I'm sure. But anyway, we appreciate your experience and willing to serve. Ms. Bronin, if I may, if confirmed, you're going to be the 12th person to chair the advisory council, but only the second to be confirmed by the Senate. That's because over 50 years, the president was able to appoint the chair without Senate confirmation. We changed the law 5 years ago to require Senate confirmation and make the office a full-time salary position in order to raise the stature of the office. So recognizing that you aren't a member of the council yet, but from what you've been able to observe of the council over the past 5 years, do you believe these reforms have made a difference?
First, thank you so much for doing that. It will make a big difference in the coming years to have a full-time chair. And I think you did that as Congress in recognition of the fact that preservation, in addition to the full-time staff that already does a great job at the agency itself, really needs a full-time champion. The first full-time chair only served for 18 months, so we're still figuring out exactly what the responsibilities and opportunities there are. When Congress first passed the National Historic Preservation Act, it recognized in the statute itself that preservation cuts across many different federal policy areas, including housing, energy efficiency, transportation, taxation, and more. So I look forward to seeing what we can do in this role together, working with agencies, working with Congress, and
well, all of us have areas in our state that have historic sites. Sometimes I've been told that it costs more to preserve one than it would to raise it and start over, but then you lose the whole cultural effect. But does that ever come into a place to where the structure, the bones are not good enough to save it? You have to make those decisions?
The advisory council doesn't play that kind of decision-making role. It's up to the individual agencies and their stewardship of historic properties to determine. But certainly you do see cases of demolition by neglect. And that's one of the reasons the Historic Preservation Act was passed in the first place.
That's
back
great.
In the 60s.
Thank you, Senator.